I never sought to be an election fraud investigator. Like all of us in this fledgling movement, I used to have a life. It was a peaceful, idyllic life. I used to make my living as an acoustic musician and as a mountaineer, blazing hiking trails and maintaining them, and as a field geologist, for I do have a doctorate in geomorphology, the study of landforms and the processes that create them and destroy them. I do have experience examining reams of data, looking for excessively fast groundwater flow. So I know how to spot highly anomalous numbers in vast reams of data. And I did grow up near Albany, New York, which then had the longest standing political machine in the United States of America, and I did know that elections are rigged at the precinct level. But I didn't have any educational background that made me an expert in any of this. What makes me an expert on the 2004 Ohio election is that I'm the one who looked at the evidence. I only used four mathematical techniques: addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. This was an audit. I distrusted the results from Ohio on election night when I saw Ohio's Secretary of State, J. Kenneth Blackwell, coincidentally the state chairman of the Bush-Cheney election campaign, stride onto the national stage, and he said that there were 155,000 provisional ballots still to be counted in Ohio. They were from all over the place. It wouldn't be enough to overcome the margin between Bush and Kerry, and that John Kerry ought to concede. I thought this was inappropriate, coming from a man who is supposed to be administering the elections in the state, to pressure a candidate into conceding. But more importantly, I knew from the experience in Florida 2000 that there must also be many regular ballots not cast provisionally for which no vote had been recorded for president, whether undervotes with no mark or punch for president or overvotes with two or more marks or punches for president. CBS News reported that there were more than 250,000 votes still uncounted in Ohio, and they declined to call Ohio for George W. Bush. They left it white on the map. Neither candidate could win without Ohio. Blackwell said that the boards of elections could not begin counting those provisional ballots for 11 days. So I went to bed expecting a long, drawn-out battle, and then the next day John Kerry conceded. And what annoyed me about that had nothing to do with the fortunes of the candidates, but the notion that some people's votes count and some people's votes don't. Now, 10 days after the election, I received an unsolicited email from Fernwoods. She turned out to be Karen Giles, who lives on a mountaintop in Pennsylvania. And she had recently added me to her massive emailing list and forwarded to me numbers from the homepage of the website of the Cuyahoga County Board of Elections, where Cleveland is located. She said, "Could someone please look at these numbers? This looks like proof to me." Well, the Board of Elections was reporting 250,000 more ballots cast than registered voters. I knew that wasn't right. So I called up the Board of Elections, and they said, "Oh, don't worry about it. This is a data entry error. It doesn't carry over to the candidates' vote totals." So I downloaded the candidates' vote totals, precinct by precinct. More than 1,400 precincts with dial-up access. It took 4 hours. So I got up at 2 o'clock in the morning, and right away I saw false results of a very different kind. There were extraordinary numbers of votes turning up in the columns of third-party presidential candidates whom I had never heard of in numerous precincts in Cleveland, the number one Democratic stronghold in the state of Ohio. So I downloaded the precinct results from the 2000 election as a comparison, and I saw that these were precincts that had voted 92, 95, even 98% for Al Gore in 2000. So these were clearly Kerry votes that had been shifted to other candidates. And I didn't know how, and I didn't know why. But it made me a witness to a crime. And my mother had taught me that a witness must come forward. Karen Giles put me in touch with Bob Fitrakis, the publisher of the Columbus Free Press. And I remember four things from that first phone conversation. He told me, "This is the sort of attention to detail that we need. We'll publish your work." He said, "This is the most difficult thing you will ever do because there is a different story in every county." He said, "This is the most important thing you will ever do, and this will make you famous." I did the work anyway. Bob Fitrakis has two qualities that made him indispensable in this investigation. He has a backbone, and he has a lot of contacts. He's got his finger on the pulse. And he gave me many leads, nearly all of which turned out to be true. The first lead I remember him telling me was the reason why there were such long lines at the polls in Columbus, Ohio, in Franklin County. We obtained records from his contacts at the Franklin County Board of Election showing that 122 voting machines were never delivered to any polling place anywhere in Franklin County. There were 68 machines never intended to be delivered that were left in the warehouse. And another 54 machines that were scheduled to be delivered, we have their serial numbers, we have the redacted list where those numbers are crossed out. All 54 of them were supposed to be delivered to precincts in Columbus, where the Democrats mainly are. And that's what caused the long lines. A shortage of voting machines that was deliberate and discriminatory. lines stretching out the door, down the street, around the block in a cold November rain. It was a simple matter to calculate what the vote count might have been if all the voting machines had been deployed and had been equitably distributed. I did the calculation based upon the percentages of the vote that Bush and Kerry got in each ward and each town in Franklin County. And I calculated that the discriminatory allocation of voting machines in Franklin County resulted in a net loss of 17,000 votes for John Kerry. The Columbus Dispatch, in an attempt to discredit us, said, oh, no, 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 we think it was more like 15,000 votes. I regard this as vindication of my work. Thank you very much. Another disturbing story that Bob Fitrakis told me had to do with electronic voting machines. About 15% of the votes in Ohio in 2004 were cast on various electronic voting machines. In Franklin County, in Columbus, there were numerous complaints in sworn affidavits from voters who would push a button for Kerry and watch the Kerry vote fade from the screen and turn into no vote for president. By comparing the percentage of undervotes in 2004 with the percentage in the 2000 election on the very same machines, I calculated that Kerry had lost another 3,000 votes in this manner. But worse yet were the complaints from Youngstown, Ohio, in Mahoning County, where they used touchscreen voting machines. There were many complaints from voters who swore that they would touch the screen for Kerry and George W. Bush would light up on the screen. There had been many layoffs in Youngstown. It seemed surprising that George W. Bush would make gains in Youngstown compared to the 2000 election. And his gains were located especially in wards 1 and 2, where the bulk of the complaints came from. And there was one precinct in Ward 2 where I was able to figure out why this happened. The Board of Elections knew about it. They reported to the press on election night that 20 to 30 touchscreen machines were hopping from Democratic to Republican candidates and had to be shut down and rebooted. In some cases, they were allowed, they were left in use all day long. But there were six complaints from Ward 2, Precinct G in Youngstown. Three voters stated that they had to scroll through twice or even five times to get their vote for Kerry to register, and this was on two different machines. Three other voters complained that they never saw a presidential choice appear on the screen. They never had the chance to vote for president. So they voted for the other offices and filed complaints. Now, shouldn't there be at least three undervotes in that precinct? No votes for president? Three more ballots cast than votes counted for president? There were zero. According to the official results, every single person who touched those screens had a vote recorded for president, whether or not they ever saw a presidential choice appear on the screen. The only explanation for this is that some of those touchscreen voting machines were programmed to default to candidate Bush. And if you intended not to vote for president or never had the chance to vote for president, you were voting for Bush. And right after I published that paper, I received 71 complaints from South Florida, from Broward, Miami-Dade, and Palm Beach counties, 2004 from voters who saw their votes hop from Democratic to Republican candidates for president and for United States Senate. And I never saw one complaint of votes hopping from Bush to Kerry. No, I never saw any complaints of votes hopping from Bush to Kerry. They were all from Kerry to Bush. There were other stories. I received a phone call from Toledo from a woman who steered me to an article in the Toledo Blade. There had been a break-in at the Democratic National Headquarters, or rather county headquarters, about 3 weeks before the election. The only thing the thieves took were the computers with all the get-out-the-vote information and all the information on campaign contributors, and this allowed the thieves to target specific wards in Toledo with various methods of voter suppression, such as steering voters to the wrong polling place. And it was about 80 precincts where the lowest percentage turnout were all Kerry precincts. There was an obvious effect on the voter turnout in Toledo from these various voter suppression activities that are detailed in my book. There were stories from red counties as well. In Miami County, Ohio, a strongly Republican county, on election night, after 100% of the precincts had reported, another 19,000 votes were added to the totals. And while the initial results did seem low, the final results seemed high. And this raised George Bush's margin of victory to 16,000 votes exactly, and left the percentages for Bush and Kerry unchanged to the hundredths of a percent, almost as if the optical scanners had been programmed to turn out that way and to provide a quota, a margin of victory. So I wondered, wouldn't this bump the percentage turnout perilously close to 100% in some precincts in Miami County? I had to wait until December 8th to get the precinct results, but yes, indeed, in Concord Southwest, the official turnout was 98.55%. 679 out of 689 voters allegedly cast ballots. It was 95% in a neighboring precinct, and only 55% in another contiguous Concord precinct, as if this remarkable degree of interest in the presidential election stopped at the precinct boundary. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever engaged in get-out-the-vote efforts, but a 98.55% turnout is impossible. You can't do it. And there was one other important story that I learned early on, this one from Cliff Arnebeck, an attorney working with Bob Fitrakis, planning a challenge to the alleged victory of George W. Bush in Ohio. This is what Reverend Jesse Jackson, before my eyes, famously termed the Connolly anomaly. It takes a bit of time to explain this, but it's important because there's a lot of votes involved. Ellen Connolly was a little-known African-American municipal judge from Cleveland who had never run a countywide race. And she was recruited to run for the Democratic nomination for Chief Justice of the Ohio Supreme Court. And she won the primary and was on the ballot in the general election running against a well-financed white male Republican incumbent named Thomas Moyer. Now, both races were close. Officially, John Kerry got 49% of the vote. Officially, Ellen Connolly got 47% of the vote, a very impressive showing. But many more people cast ballots for president than for chief justice. There were roughly 6 million votes for president, 4.8 million for chief justice. So 2 out of 10 people who cast ballots for president made no choice for chief justice, and this is to be expected. Down ticket races do not draw as many votes as the top of the ticket. So you would expect, since both races were close, that the presidential candidates, both of them, would get more votes than the chief justice candidates in county after county in Ohio. But there were 12 counties in southwestern Ohio, some of the most conservative counties in the state, where Kerry got fewer votes than Ellen Connolly. Not just a smaller percentage, fewer votes. In the 3 counties that surround Hamilton, where Cincinnati is located in the southwest corner of the state, Butler, Claremont, and Warren, the 3 counties which between them accounted for George Bush's entire statewide margin of victory, there had to be at least 13,000 people, the same souls in the same voting booths in the same day, who voted for a liberal black judge from Cleveland for chief justice and for George W. Bush for president, or else the official results were not true and correct. And this would be a net, because some people no doubt voted for Chief Justice Moyer and for John Kerry. So really there'd have to be 13,500 more Bush-Connolly voters than Kerry-Moyer voters. Now, I interviewed Ellen Connolly. She never set foot in southwestern Ohio. She had not one yard sign in southwestern Ohio. She spent one nickel per vote received in the state of Ohio. And yet John Kerry, the most well-funded Democratic presidential candidate in the history of this country, could not get as many votes as Ellen Connolly in 12 counties. In fact, in 3 of these counties, John Kerry was awarded fewer votes than Al Gore had gotten in 2000, despite a massive increase in turnout in 2004. Al Gore did not contest Ohio in 2004. He pulled out of Ohio 1 month before the election to concentrate his resources in Florida. So what the official results were telling me is that in some of these counties in Ohio, George W. Bush got all the new voters, all the Nader voters, because he had been disqualified from the ballot by the courts, and some of the Gore voters, or the equivalent, or else the official results were not true and correct. Now, I wrote up a lot of papers during this time, and another one that I must point to here analyzed those uncounted regular ballots in Ohio. The 93,000 votes cast by regular voters at the polls, where no vote was recorded for president. These were mostly punch cards. And they came disproportionately from blue counties, especially from precincts that had voted overwhelmingly for John Kerry. And I was able to do that paper for these heavily populated counties in Ohio, precinct by precinct by precinct, because I had a lot of people helping me. My first radio appearance was in Berkeley on Larry Bensky's Sunday Salon, and enough people heard me that they volunteered to help. I had people who turned precinct data into spreadsheets and tables for me, because I didn't even know how to make a spreadsheet. And I had another person, Ellis Goldberg, to gather precinct data from sometimes recalcitrant boards of elections. And I had Emily Levy to coordinate the whole project. So I was able to write 21 papers in 6 weeks and present them to the Ohio Supreme Court and be deposed under oath for 4 hours in a lonesome hotel room in front of a court reporter. While we never did get a hearing, there was no discovery of evidence, no deposition of hostile witnesses. In Ohio, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court gets to hear election challenges all by his lonesome. You can appeal his decision to the full court, but if there's no decision, there's nothing to appeal. So we never got a hearing, and I thought it came with rather poor grace and had the appearance of a conflict of interest for Chief Justice Moyer not to give us a hearing on our challenge to the alleged victory of George W. Bush, especially since we were also challenging the alleged victory of Thomas Moyer, because we had evidence in other counties that votes had been shifted from Connolly to Moyer. I remember in Florida 2000, there was only one lever of government in the state of Florida that the Republicans did not control. That would be the Supreme Court. And it would have been dramatic indeed if a newly inaugurated Chief Justice Connolly had convened an emergency hearing on January 2nd, 4 days before the election was to be challenged on the floor of the Congress, thanks to the courageous Congresswoman Stephanie Tubbs Jones, who died recently, who was the first public official to receive my works, because it was in her district where those carry votes were shifting to third-party candidates. Well, I continued to examine precinct results even into 2005 and 2006 because these volunteers had been so enthusiastic that they obtained precinct results for 82% of the state of Ohio. A couple of more papers that I wrote, mainly for national conferences, that I should point out here. I investigated some other Connolly anomaly counties, and two of my favorites were these in Auglaize County, where the deputy director of the Board of Elections resigned in humiliation a few weeks before the election after an ES&S voting machine company technician gained unauthorized access to their central tabulator. When I looked at the precinct results, I saw that John Kerry ran behind not just Ellen Connolly, but nearly every Democrat on the ticket. He got fewer votes than all three Democratic candidates for the Ohio Supreme Court, and got fewer votes than the Democratic candidates who lost in landslides for Congress, state representative, and county commissioner. Here's one example on page 150 in my book, Union Township. Kerry gets 188 votes. Ellen Connolly, 290. Ben Konop, the losing candidate for Congress, gets 399 compared to 188 for Kerry. In Mercer County, Ohio, another Connolly anomaly county. On election night, there were reports that the Mercer County Board of Elections had posted on their website more ballots cast than the total population of the county. Well, those numbers were taken down. And when I asked for the precinct results for the 2004 general election, they sent me the results for the primary. That's not what I asked for. I was annoyed, especially since I'd had to pay money for this. When I finally got the precinct results for the general election, I thought, well, why not compare them to the primary? I've got the results. And lo and behold, there were four precincts in Mercer County where John Kerry and John Edwards got more votes between them in the primary in March than the ticket was awarded in the November election, with obviously a much higher turnout in November, which is to say that Bush got the votes of everybody who didn't vote in the primary, and every Democrat who didn't vote for Kerry or Edwards, and even some of the Kerry and Edwards voters, or else the official results were not true and correct. And there was one more paper that I will mention now that I wrote for a national conference in Houston, which I satirically called Log Cabin Republicans in Ohio. Ohio was one of many states that had proposed constitutional amendments on the ballot to ban gay marriage or anything resembling it. And we all know that one of the reasons for these amendments was to turn out the rural white evangelical base of the Republican Party, who maybe didn't vote in 2000 and they would be more likely to vote for Bush than for Kerry. Well, issue one, as it was known, the ban on gay marriage passed overwhelmingly with 61% of the vote, and almost everybody voted on it. There were very few undervotes or no votes on issue one. So if issue one, the ban on gay marriage, got 61% of the vote, and George Bush got 51% of the vote, you would expect issue one to get more votes than George W. Bush in county after county in Ohio. But there were three counties out of 88, by definition, an anomaly, where you couldn't account for George Bush's vote totals unless there were at least 10,000 gay-friendly Bush voters. And again, this was a net. There were surely many people who voted for John Kerry and voted to ban gay marriage. After all, the ban passed overwhelmingly with 61% of the vote. So there had to be many more than 10,000. Now, this is the paper that brought me to the attention of Rolling Stone magazine. And I got an email from Tim Dickinson, a contributing editor, asking if I would be willing to be interviewed. I'm a musician. That was a really easy call. So I had a long talk with Tim Dickinson, and he said that Robert F. Kennedy Jr. was writing an article for Rolling Stone magazine on whether or not the 2004 election was stolen in Ohio, and would I be willing to help research the article in addition to all the research I'd already done. So I traveled back to Ohio out of pocket as usual to investigate for Rolling Stone magazine whether or not the voter rolls in Cuyahoga County, where Cleveland is located, had been purged. It turned out that between the 2000 and 2004 elections, 168,000 names had been purged from the voter rolls in Cuyahoga County, including 64,000 in Cleveland alone, the number one Democratic stronghold in the state. More than 30% of the voters in entire wards. Now, there is a reason to purge the voter rolls. People do die or move away, and you don't want somebody voting in their place. In Ohio, the boards of elections do have the option of placing these voters who have not voted in 4 years, have never contacted the Board of Election, have no activity for 4 years, the boards of elections can place them on an inactive list. They still appear on the voter rolls, but then they need to show identification to show that they do still live in the same place, and then they're allowed to vote. But Cuyahoga County chose to purge them from the voter rolls altogether. So if these voters then turned up at the polls and wanted to vote, they'd be given a provisional ballot and it wouldn't be counted because they're not on the rolls. In fact, the two counties with the highest percentages of uncounted provisional ballots in Ohio were Lucas County, where Toledo is located, where more than 40% of the provisional ballots were rejected, and Cuyahoga County, where Cleveland is located, where more than 30% of the provisional ballots were rejected. It was during this time, in the spring of 2006, when I was working on the article for Rolling Stone magazine, that the Attorney General of the state of Ohio, Jim Petro, ruled that the ballots were in fact public record. It was a little late It was now a year and a half after the election, and now maybe we were gonna get to look at the actual forensic evidence. So I sent out public records requests to some of the most suspect counties in Ohio, asking the boards of elections to allow us to photograph ballots for precincts of my choice. And not just the ballots, but the poll books, the voter signature books, the ballot accounting charts, whatever records we could obtain that would help us to audit this presidential election in the state that decided the election. Now, there seems to be some confusion lately as to what constitutes an election audit. There are people who want us to believe that recounting the ballots in a very small percentage of precincts randomly chosen constitutes an audit. No, that's a spot check. When the IRS audits your tax returns, you don't get to decide what documents to provide them. They want it all. And we wanted it all. First of all, elections are stolen at the precinct level. The elections are rigged where they can rig them. It's not an across-the-board thing with alterations in every precinct in the county. But here's a really good example of why just recounting the ballots is not sufficient. If you don't look at the voter signature books and the absentee voter lists and the provisional voter lists, you don't know if you're looking at the right number of ballots. You don't know if that ballot box has been stuffed or if ballots have been destroyed. So we wanted to conduct a full audit in as many precincts in as many suspect counties as we could. And time was running out. Under federal law and state law and directive of the Secretary of State, those ballots only had to be retained until Labor Day weekend, 2006. J. Kenneth Blackwell is not culpable on this point. He did his duty on this point. He issued not one, but two directives to all boards of elections in Ohio saying, quote, all ballots, used and unused, must be retained for at least 22 months. That is not ambiguous. So Destruction Day was looming, September 2nd. We only had a few months to gather this evidence. And I would sometimes go alone. I would sometimes go with as many as three other photographers. And no doubt it was unnerving for these boards of elections to have teams of citizen volunteers equipped with digital cameras descending upon them, taking pictures all day long, day after day, as if we were the FBI, whose job we were doing because they would not do it. It was an entirely new experience for everyone concerned. Now, we audited red counties, and we audited blue counties. We did not find red counties rigged for Bush and blue counties rigged for Kerry. We found red counties and blue counties rigged for Bush. The methodologies differed, and that's precisely what Bob Fetrakis had told me in that first phone call, that there was a different story in every county, which gives you an idea the contacts he has in the boards of elections in Ohio. I'll start with blue counties. I'll tell you three ways the votes were rigged in blue counties in Ohio. Why were there so many ballots, mostly punch cards, on which no vote was recorded for president in the most heavily Democratic precincts in the state of Ohio? It wasn't hanging chads. In the eight urban counties that we audited, we saw about 20 of them, for president, next to none. Rather, most, more than half, in some counties, two-thirds of the ballots that we photographed that showed no vote for president had two or more punches. There would be a punch for a major party candidate and a punch for a minor party candidate. A punch for Kerry or Bush, but these were heavily Democratic precincts, so it was nearly always for Kerry. And a punch for Michael Badnarik or Michael Perutka, or both. Especially in precincts where Kerry and Bush appeared at the top of the list and the third party candidates appeared at the bottom, where a voter might punch a hole for Kerry and would be unlikely to scroll down the ballot to see if anybody else had been kind enough to already punch their ballots for them. We photographed more than 2,000 of these double-punched ballots, representing 1/12 of the data set in these eight urban counties, 8.3% of the uncounted ballots. I'm not saying there are 24 double punches. I didn't view every ballot in Ohio, but there could be that many. I found it really hard to believe that so many voters, 6, 8, 10, even 12% of the voters in precincts in the inner cities made the same mistakes, two mistakes. He'd punch for Kerry and then punch for another presidential candidate, not realizing which race they were voting on, and be punching for a candidate they never heard of before. There are complaints from voters who swear that they were given punch cards already punched for president. And if they had put those ballots in the punch card machines and punched for Kerry, they'd be ruining their own ballots. I don't know how many of these are voter error and how many are fraud, but some of them are fraudulent. And the pre-punching of ballots to ruin votes expected to be cast for Kerry could not have been done by the boards of elections. Punch card ballots were shipped by the printer to the board of elections in shrink-wrapped pads of 100 or more, and were passed on to the polling places still shrink-wrapped. The boards of elections did not have the opportunity to pre-punch these ballots. Any pre-punching of ballots must have been done at the factory or somewhere else before they were shipped to the boards of elections, which would explain why we saw the same pattern in eight urban counties. The only method of vote rigging that we saw crossing county lines. Now, why did so many Kerry votes migrate to other candidates in Cleveland and on occasion in other cities in Ohio? Well, there were many polling places in Cleveland and other large cities where multiple precincts voted in the same polling place. And under Ohio law, the sequence, the order in which candidates' names appear on the ballot must rotate from precinct to precinct. This is all in the name of fairness, to give every candidate an equal chance to be listed first on the ballot, because it is alleged that many voters are so lazy or so stupid that they do not read through the whole list of names and they vote for the first person listed, even in a presidential election. Now, on punch cards, the names are not printed on the ballot. There's only numbers corresponding to perforated rectangles that you punch. The names are printed on a booklet that is attached to the voting machine. The names are in great big block letters with numbers and arrows that point to the place where you're supposed to punch for your candidate. So if you took your correct punch card and took it to the wrong voting booth, most likely because it was the shortest line, you thought you were punching for Kerry. The booklet told you you were punching for Kerry, But when you then put that punch card in the correct ballot box for your precinct, the tabulator would read it for another candidate. We have photographic proof in Cleveland of Kerry votes migrating not just to Badnarik and Perutka, but to candidate disqualified, that would be Ralph Nader, who managed to get more than 80 votes in one of these precincts, as if 80 voters lined up for an hour or more to vote for candidate disqualified. And we have proof of votes migrating to George W. Bush. The way the ballot rotation worked, it's alphabetical in the first precinct, and then the guy on the top, it drops to the bottom in the second precinct. Everybody moves up one. So the positions were Bush, Kerry, Nader. If voters from this precinct are allowed to go to that precinct and their votes shift from Kerry to Nader, then the way it works is that if voters from that precinct go to this precinct, their Kerry votes shift to Bush. In that very polling place where Nader got 80 votes in one precinct, Bush got 80 votes in the other one. And he only got 2 absentee votes in that precinct. We have other precincts like this. And there's one other aspect of these multiple precinct polling places that allowed vote riggers to siphon off Kerry votes in all the urban centers in Ohio. Each precinct had its own table. And there was rarely anybody at the door to tell you which table to go to, which line to stand in. So voters naturally would tend to go to the shortest line if they didn't know where they were supposed to go. And they'd stand in line for maybe an hour and go up to the table and they wouldn't be on the voter rolls. And unless the poll worker said, oh, you're in the wrong precinct, you need to go to the back of that line and stand for another hour and vote over there. Instead, they'd be given a provisional ballot and it wouldn't count because it was cast in the wrong precinct. They were in the right building, but at the wrong table. Now, you can't rig red counties the same way you're going to rig blue counties if you're rigging it for George W. Bush, because if you let voters go to the wrong voting booth or go to the wrong table or have ballots punched in advance, it's going to be Bush who loses the lion's share of the votes. So different methods were used in the Connolly anomaly counties. One method, tried and true, was ballot box stuffing. In 4 of the Connolly anomaly counties, Claremont, Dark, Van Wert, and Mercer, we photographed or photocopied in nearly every precinct we audited substantially more ballots than the total number issued to the voters. Not just one or two more. This wasn't a case of people forgetting to sign the register. In some cases, 24 extra ballots or 20 extra ballots. Some of those ballots were never touched by voters. And if some of the ballots are fake, how do we know that any of the ballots are real? In Dark County, you gotta love the name. There were punch card ballots that were blank on the backside, didn't even identify the year, much less the county or the precinct, or have the facsimile signatures of the Board of Elections. They were blank. They were wild card ballots that could be used on an as-needed basis in any county in Ohio to stuff the ballot box. In Dark County, we audited 9 Connolly anomaly precincts and photographed 70 more ballots than the number issued to the voters. In Mercer County, there was an extra signature on the back of the punch card, which told me it wasn't printed by Dayton Legal Blank that prints the ballots for 90% of the counties in Ohio. And not only that, but the second signature of a Board of Elections member, Owen V. Hall, was actually cut off in a line that curved upward to the left, cutting right through the first letter of his name, and you could see two letters from some other signature sticking out on the left-hand side as though they were all done from a cut-and-taped original. Again, if some of the ballots are fake, how do we know that any of the ballots are real? Some other methods that were used in red counties, ballot alteration is one. We audited two counties that used optical scanners. In Miami County, the favorite method of ballot alteration was to take ballots that had no mark for president, that were undervotes, and fill it in for Bush. You could see that it was a different hand or a different writing implement. The most obvious example was the one where all the other marks for all the other candidates were back and forth squiggles, and the mark for Bush was a nice solid block filling in the oval. Miami County also had 570 remakes. The boards of elections in Ohio are allowed to remake ballots that they don't think are being read properly by the punch card tabulator or the optical scanner. And they are supposed to keep the ballots that they are allegedly duplicating and number them so that you can match them up. And there was not one county in Ohio that could produce for us the original spoiled ballots which they were allegedly duplicating. The 570 remakes in Miami County were especially interesting because they were found in a box labeled December 16th. These were recount remakes. These were ballots that were remade to try to survive the recount paid for by the Green and Libertarian parties, with no support from the Democrats, I might add. The Green Party observers to the recount saw this and questioned the choices made by board members on some of these remade ballots. Now, the way the recount works, the Green and Libertarian parties paid $10 per precinct for a recount in the state of Ohio, and they didn't get it. They wanted all the ballots recounted, but what actually happened was this. Each board of elections was supposed to pick at random in front of the observers precincts amounting to 3% of the ballots cast and then count those by hand, and if the hand count matched the official results, then they could run the other 97% of the ballots through the tabulators or through the scanners and go home. Well, even with all these remakes in Miami County, the numbers still didn't match. The hand count didn't match the official results. So J. Kenneth Blackwell dispatched one of his operatives from the Secretary of State's office to Miami County to interpret election law for them. And he said, it doesn't matter that the hand count does not match the official results. It only has to match today's tabulator count. This is an exercise in hand counting to see if you can get it right, and then we run it through the tabulators or through the scanners and see if you got it right. So there was no genuine recount in Miami County. The big question in Miami County was voter turnout, especially Concord Southwest with its Saddam Hussein-like 98.55% turnout. Now, the main thing I wanted to look at was the voter signature books, and on the day that the Miami County Board of Elections received my records request, the deputy director, a registered Democrat, coincidentally resigned. The director, a registered Republican, a former military intelligence operative named Steve Quillen, turned out to be the most cooperative and transparent Board of Elections official we encountered in any county in Ohio. And he actually helped with the investigation. And he gave us free access to all the records, said we can photograph or film anything we want. In fact, we filmed the recounted ballots to verify what the observers at the recount had seen, that these ballots in the three hand-counted precincts were already sorted according to presidential candidate before they were allegedly hand-counted in front of witnesses. I investigated three precincts where it appeared that the ballot box had been stuffed, and by comparing ballot stub numbers in various signature books in those cities and townships, I was able to verify this. Now, the original explanation from the Board of Elections as to why the voter turnout data was so askew, especially in Concord Township, but also in Troy City and Tipp City, was this. The Board of Elections withheld a percentage of the ballots, maybe 20%, on election day instead of delivering them to the precincts because maybe some people don't know where they're supposed to vote and we'll let them vote downtown at the Board of Elections. Well, according to J. Kenneth Blackwell's directive, their votes shouldn't have counted because they didn't vote in their precinct. After all, that rule was rigidly adhered to in the blue urban counties of Ohio. But the line went like this. Some of these polling places were in danger of running out of ballots because of unexpectedly high turnout. And so teams of volunteer Boy Scouts were dispatched to deliver ballots to the polling places, and those darn Boy Scouts must have brought the wrong ballots to the wrong precincts. Well, I used to be a Boy Scout. This rather offended me that Boy Scouts were being fingered as the vote riggers in Miami County. So yeah, I audited the signature books and all the ballot stub numbers in some of these suspect precincts, photographed the ballots, and was able to demonstrate that the Boy Scouts were not the culprits. And it's interesting to note that for them to deliver Concord ballots to the wrong precinct, they didn't all vote in the same polling place. The Boy Scouts must have confused a Nazarene church with a United Auto Workers meeting hall. So here's an example where we needed a list of which precincts voted where, just like we needed it in Cleveland to show how votes were shifted from Kerry to other candidates. But we photographed every single poll book in Miami County, and by comparing the number of names of persons who voted by regular, provisional, and absentee ballot, we found that the official results were wrong, not just in the 98.55% turnout precinct, but in all 82 precincts in Miami County. And Steve Quillen, the director of the Board of Elections, with his inquisitive mind and his sense of duty as a former military intelligence operative, commanded his computerized voter database with the voting histories to tell him, precinct by precinct, how many voters who were still registered to vote in Miami County had been registered in November 2004, and if they voted. And we came in one day and he told us these words, "You guys are right." He handed us a printout showing us that the official results were wrong in all 82 precincts in Miami County. The other county we audited that had optical scanners was Claremont County. And the favorite method of rigging votes there was to take little white oval stickers and place them over the mark for Kerry and then fill in the mark for Bush and run those ballots through the scanners. The witnesses to the recount in December saw many of these. And those would be just in the precincts that were hand counted. They were only observing 3% of the ballots for the county. So the Green and Libertarian and Democratic witnesses confronted the Board of Elections three times about this and signed affidavits. Bob Drake, the Green Party witness, with whom I've spoken many times and have met face to face twice, told me that on one of these occasions, an employee of the Board of Elections asked him if he would carry boxes upstairs for her, and the reason was she wanted to talk to him privately and tell him what happened. And she told him that the director of the Board of Elections, a registered Republican, Danny Bear, sent the deputy director, a registered Democrat, home on election day because she was sick, and he had access to the ballots all alone and came down the stairs with a box full of stickered ballots. And at the third confrontation, according to Bob Drake and other witnesses, Danny Bear admitted attaching those stickers himself. No, he's not in jail. It took us 11 weeks to get past an array of county prosecutors who wanted to prevent us from photographing those ballots. They wanted to make photocopies at 10 cents a page at great expense. And I wouldn't allow it. I told an assistant county prosecutor, Mary Lynn Burke, that we know about the stickered ballots. And a photocopy of a white sticker on a black and white ballot will not suffice. We need true color photographs. And so she said, well, there really weren't very many of them. Well, so I asked her, how many would that be? And she sent me a letter. She told me in writing there were fewer than 100 of them, which would, I guess, be in 3% of the precincts of the county. So I told her, ma'am, that would be fewer than 100 felonies, and that's why we need to use cameras. Now, you know, I learned long ago when seeking incriminating confessions never to ask whether, but to ask how many, how much, how often. I could not believe an assistant county prosecutor had fallen into this trap. So they let us in with cameras, and there was only one stickered presidential ballot remaining. The others had been replaced with pristine remakes, and the Board of Elections would have had to dip into the stash of unused ballots in order to make those remakes, and then they had to destroy the unused ballots because they didn't have enough of them left over to survive an audit. And they destroyed the ballot stubs that are torn off the voted ballots because you could no longer verify that the ballots we were photographing were the ballots that were issued to the voters, though that wasn't even necessary anyway, because they never recorded the ballot stub numbers in the voter signature books in the first place. We photographed those. There was not one. We saw a lot of forged signatures, but not one ballot stub. We also found that the absentee ballot boxes were stuffed in all the precincts that were machine counted, that we audited. There were always more absentee ballots than the total number issued to the voters. And the signature books didn't even tell us if the voters had returned their ballots in a timely manner. This was more absentee ballots than the total number issued to the voters in precinct after precinct. We don't know how many extras there were. And the most interesting thing about the absentee ballots was this. It proved to me that in Claremont County, the Board of Elections decided no later than November 2nd, no later than Election Day, which precincts were going to be hand-counted and subjected to public scrutiny in December if it came to a recount, and here's how I know. They did give us a circular dated 4 days before the recount, already naming the precincts to be chosen 4 days later to be counted by hand. They picked the smallest precincts because they were the easiest ones to get the counts to match. But the absentee ballots were the giveaway. Absentees looked just the same as regular ballots in the optical scanner counties. And the absentee ballots in the hand-counted precincts were always denoted with a letter A written by hand in the upper right-hand corner in red ink. The absentee ballots in the other precincts we audited that were machine counted in December were denoted differently. They were denoted with an annoying little red smiley-faced rubber stamp in the upper right-hand corner. Have a nice day. And why would they be marked differently? The absentee ballots were mixed in with the regular ballots on election night, and they had a different way of marking the precincts that just happened to get hand-counted in December. They knew before Election Day which precincts to leave unmolested so they could survive the scrutiny of a hand-count if it came to that and rig the other precincts. And that could be why, in this heavily Republican county, John Kerry got 33% of the vote in the hand-counted precincts and 23% of the vote in the machine-counted precincts that we audited. And we don't know how many other counties in Ohio did this, but it's long been suspected that a small number of precincts were left alone for this purpose. I also know, and this is very disturbing for states that still use optical scanners, Claremont County did their own programming, and I know that the optical scanners were programmed not to read the mark for Ralph Nader. They left him on the ballot illegally, which would tempt voters who maybe would be more likely to vote for Kerry than for Bush to mark it for Nader. And instead of programming the scanners to count Nader as zero, which is how they programmed the tabulators for punch cards in other counties, in this optical scan county, Claremont County programmed their tabulators not to recognize a mark for Bush. I mean for Nader. They programmed the scanners not to recognize a mark for Nader, and then they could fill in the Bush mark and count it for Bush. We saw not one ballot that was double marked for Kerry and Nader. It was always Bush and Nader. And the observers to the recount saw the same thing and complained about it. And there are precincts, in the precincts where we have these double marked ballots for Bush and Nader, we have every single ballot in the precincts, we have the official results, and we know that they were not counted as overvotes, that they were counted for Bush. I find this disturbing. For states that are relying on optical scanners, even precinct-based optical scanners, to read paper ballots. If an optical scanner can be programmed not to read a mark for a candidate, can it be programmed not to read every 10th mark or every 20th mark for the candidate? I have three more red counties to bring to your attention. In Butler County in southwestern Ohio, where Bush got his biggest margin of victory, when we were photographing punch card ballots, Lori Davis, a ranking employee of the Board of Elections, a gracious, charming woman whom I would trust with my children if I had any, told us these words. Unsolicited. The punch cards have always worked well for us. The tabulators have always worked well in the past. We have always done our own programming. But for some reason, on the morning of Election Day, a technician from the ES&S voting machine company showed up unannounced at the Board of Elections office and reprogrammed all six of our tabulators. Thank you for sharing that information, I thought to myself. And this could be why a count of the ballots photographed in precinct after precinct that we audited failed to match the tabulator count. More often than not, the disparity in one manner or another amounted to 25 or 50 votes, give or take one or two. This tells me that those tabulators were very likely programmed to start at plus 50 for Bush and minus 50 for Kerry in the big precincts, and plus 25 for Bush and minus 25 for Kerry in the little precincts. And then the total number of ballots cast would turn out right, and nobody's any the wiser unless somebody actually gets to look at the ballots. And then if you have to rig the ballots after the fact to match the rigged tabulator count to survive an audit, here's what you'd have to do. You paw through the deck of cards, you sort out 50 ballots punched for Kerry from somewhere in the middle of the deck, and you replace them with 50 ballots punched for Bush and punched the same way for other offices. And if you place those 50 fake Bush ballots at the top of the deck and forget to shuffle the cards, you're going to leave exactly what we found. We found runs of 50 consecutive ballots for Bush more than once in Butler County, and there was one precinct with 50 consecutive ballots for Bush at the top of the deck and 212 consecutive ballots for Bush in the middle of the deck. This is not the sequence in which those ballots were dropped into the ballot box by the voters on election night. It proves unauthorized access to the ballots. It is ballot tampering. Those ballots are supposed to be in double-locked vaults where the Republicans got one key and the Democrats got the other. And we saw the same thing in Delaware County, Ohio, north of Columbus. Delaware first came to my attention because they had a 45% increase in turnout. For every 100 people who cast ballots in Bush versus Gore in 2000, there were 145 who cast ballots in 2004, Bush versus Kerry. Now, yes, Delaware County was the fastest growing county in the state, but not that fast. So I always suspected they had too many ballots cast in the official results. The second reason Delaware County came to my attention is because that's the county in which the Board of Elections went to federal court to try to stop the recount in December, paid for by the Green and Libertarian parties, and it was the Democratic Party in Delaware County that led the charge. And the third thing that came to my attention in Delaware County is they had the largest number of gay-friendly Bush voters. Now, the first day we showed up at the Delaware County Board of Elections, and this is my first visit to any of them, Kim Spangler, the director, and Janet Brenneman, the deputy director, were clearly annoyed. Kim and Janet didn't think we needed to be looking at the ballots, and they asked me why I needed to see them. And I told her that I had found the results surprising, that there had to be at least 3,000 gay-friendly Bush voters and maybe twice as many. And I guess they already knew about this anomaly because they had their answers ready. They both told us, almost in unison as if rehearsed, three things. First, they both said they have family members who are gay, and they proceeded to identify them. Now, the same relation, yes. And I felt this was inappropriate. I think gay people should get to decide for themselves whether or not to reveal their sexual orientation and should not be outed by family members in front of total strangers in the county office building. Then Kim and Janet told us that there was a large gay contingent on the campus in Delaware. That would be Ohio Wesleyan Methodist University. And then they both told us that all the Delaware shop owners are gay. Three times they said this. All of them? Yes, all of them. Oh, I did not know that. Oh, yes, all of them. Well, you know, this is the explanation. So, of course, being crime scene investigators, you know, we went and checked it out. We started canvassing the downtown stores and asking, is it true that all the shop owners are gay? I'll give you three responses. You know, Kim and Janet are drama queens. I mean, they really gave me a lot of entertainment. So we go door to door. The guy in the Sherwin-Williams store is pacing side to side behind the counter and saying, oh, well, I'm just the manager. I'm not the owner. We went to the taxi cab company figuring they surely know. They drive people around all hours of the morning. And they told us, quote, Delaware is not a gay mecca. So I then went to the Visitors Bureau posing as a gay urban professional and said, we just drove up from Columbus along the river road and it's really beautiful and we're thinking about moving here and I want brochures on gay owned and operated restaurants, bed and breakfasts, and campgrounds. And they'd ask, you know, why do you think we have those? They said, well, we have it on good authority from the Board of Elections that Delaware has a large gay population. Well, who told you that? Oh, Kim and Janet. Well, they could not even refer me to a business that flies a rainbow flag. So I began to suspect that the story is not true, that Delaware has no large gay population, and that the election results were fraudulent. So we still wanted to look at ballots. I remember asking a question in a very friendly way, saying, this is the second straight presidential election in which Delaware County had the lowest rate of undervotes of any punch card county in Ohio. You must be very proud of that. Oh, why, yes, we hire a mentally retarded man to scrape the chads from the ballots before we run them through the tabulators. What? We heard this story three times. I mean, mind you, when we finally got a chance to look at the ballots, we were not allowed to touch them. They had to be handled by a Republican and a Democrat. But they're going to hand them to a, their words, mentally retarded man, on election night, which explains why they don't have any undervotes, hardly, in Delaware County. Well, you know, the timeline doesn't work. Chad Scraper, as he's affectionately known, had to examine and clean as needed 79,000 punch card ballots in 4.5 hours. We know when their results were reported. Another timeline that doesn't work has to do with the voter registrations. I asked him to tell me how many voters were purged before the 2004 election, and she dutifully told me how many were purged before and after. And so I went back to the office and constructed a timeline, something I have learned to do from watching the television show Without a Trace. You know, if the timeline doesn't work, somebody is lying. And I constructed a timeline of how many voters were officially registered in every primary and general election from 2000 onward, and factored in the two purges of the voter rolls on the dates that they were purged. And I came back and said, okay, Kim, you had 78,000 registered voters after the purge in April 2004. You had 100,000 registered voters by the deadline in October. I want the names of all 22,000 people who registered to vote during that six-month period to bring your total from 78,000 to 100,000. They could not produce the names. They gave me a spreadsheet with 16,000 names, 6,000 names short. Their reported number of registered voters countywide was fraudulent in a county that claimed to have 81% turnout countywide. If they only had 93,000 registered voters, then they, or 94,000, they only had 87% turnout. I mean, they claimed, or rather, they had 87% turnout. And if another 6,000 or 7,000 were purged after the election because they were inactive, they would tell me that 87% of the registered voters and 93% of the active voters countywide turned out to the polls in Delaware County. Well, naturally, we still wanted to look at ballots, and they were not amused. Not once, not twice, but 5 times the Delaware County Board of Elections called out armed, uniformed, paramilitary policemen to try to stop us from looking at the ballots. I am not easily intimidated. I walked up to this man. I looked at his shoulder patch. It said Global Security Services. And I went back to the office, and I ran a web search, and their homepage boasted that they were comprised of former Secret Service, FBI, CIA, and special military ops such as Navy SEALs. That is who the Delaware County Board of Elections felt were needed to protect them from the likes of us wanting to look at public records. We finally did get a look at the ballots. They were actually on their best behavior the day we looked at our first precinct because we were accompanied by Jeff Kirkby sporting a valid White House press pass. And Kim told me I could come back in June after the primary and look at more precincts. So I went back to the Adirondack Mountains in New York for my annual stint clearing trails in the mountains. And returned in June, called up Kim, said, remember you said we could look at more ballots? And she said yes, but we want you to resubmit your records request in your name only because we don't like the people you've been coming with and we want to work with you alone. Well, some lights went off in my head and here's why. There was one day when we turned up at the Board of Elections after a 1 week absence, and one of these Global Security Services goons was staking out the building. Had he been staking it out for a week? We'd been gone that long. He saw our van pull up, and he took off and ran into the building. I chased him. I'm chasing an armed uniformed paramilitary policeman into the county office building. I chased him down the hall. I chased him around the corner. I watched him duck into the Board of Elections office and lock the door behind him during business hours. And I watched Kim Spangler, the director of the Board of Elections, scurry across the floor, duck into her office, and crouch beneath the window. Behavior indicative of someone with something to hide. So I went back to the office, and my dear friend Troy Seaman said, Richard, they are not worried about you. This guy is a lookout. They're tampering with the ballots. You need to do two things. You need to find out if they have been contacting Dayton Legal Blank and ordering more ballots. I got their telephone records, and yes, indeed, they faxed my records request to Dayton Legal Blank 10 minutes after receiving it. And he told me I needed to have a look at a precinct without notice. They've been making me submit public records requests in advance with the precinct specified, giving them time to rig the decks of cards. So now Kim is saying she wants me to resubmit the public records request. And I said, sure, Kim, how much time do you need? And she said, give us 24 hours. I said, fine, how about tomorrow? And I faxed a new public records request. I dutifully cut and pasted all the names of the townships, and I changed the precincts. I show up the next morning with Stuart Wright, a kindly elderly gentleman whom they won't object to, and there's three decks of cards for Genoa Township Precinct I on the table, and they're all sorted according to presidential candidate. The absentee ballots on the top were all one candidate and then all the other. The second deck of cards was all one candidate and then all the other. The third deck of cards had a hot pink remake on the top, three straggling absentee ballots for Bush and Nader, and then 359 consecutive ballots for George W. Bush, not a carry ballot in the stack. This is not the sequence in which voters drop their ballots into the polls on election night, into the ballot box on election night. It proves ballot tampering and unauthorized access to the ballots. Does it prove ballot box stuffing? How on earth would we know? We don't even know how many registered voters there were. I did consider that maybe there'd been a tent revival in Genoa Township that night, and nine busloads of God-fearing Christians had been delivered in to the polls after the last carry voter lined up. But first of all, they'd all have to be registered in the same precinct. And second of all, 100 of those 359 ballots were punched for gay marriage. So I was forced to conclude that this was ballot tampering. I have one more county, and I think many of you might have heard about it. Warren County, Ohio. This is where a phony terrorist threat was staged on election night by county officials, and they locked down the county building so that unwanted observers and the news media would not be able to watch the ballots being counted. The story was broken by Erica Solvig of the Cincinnati Inquirer, fresh out of college. She noticed that Warren County had not reported their election results at midnight, and she drove up to find out why and found the county building surrounded by police cars and bomb-sniffing dogs. So she investigated. She called up the principals of the two elementary schools that are barely a stone's throw from the Board of Elections building, and they hadn't been notified of any terrorist threat. She called up the FBI and the state police, and they didn't know of any terrorist threat in any county in the state of Ohio. She obtained emails dated 7 and 8 days before the election, back and forth between two county officials, registered Republicans, the director of building services and the director of emergency services, planning the lockdown in advance, even deciding upon the wording that would be printed on the signs posted on the county building. She found out that the county commissioners approved the lockdown 5 days in advance behind closed doors, and I found out from interviewing the director of the Board of Elections that the board was notified a couple of days before the election that the building would be locked down after the polls had closed. And ladies and gentlemen, there is a reason for this, or there is a word for this sort of behavior. It is called conspiracy. Now, we have eyewitnesses, one of whom drew a map of the buildings. And he says that the ballots were carried from the polling places, not to the Board of Elections, but to an unauthorized warehouse, the Building Services Storage Facility, under the control of the Director of Building Services, one of the co-conspirators who wrote those emails. And that the ballots were kept there for 3 or 4 hours while ballot tampering occurred. And then were brought in through the back door, through the loading dock in the northeast corner, which is what Erica Solvig saw herself at 12:30 in the morning. And I asked the director of the Board of Elections how late the last ballots arrived, and she said 12:30 in the morning. We have the ballot accounting charts from many precincts in Warren County. Many of them state what time the ballots left the polling places. The last time we saw, the latest hour we saw, was 9:30 p.m. If ballots were still arriving at 12:30 in the morning, then they did indeed have 3 hours or more to tamper with the ballots. The way the chain of custody worked was this. The ballots were carried from the polling places by the precinct judges all by their lonesome. And the precinct judges were members of whatever political party carried that precinct in the previous governor's election. In Warren County, that would be 157 Republicans and 0 Democrats. And I asked the director of the Board of Elections to verify the chain of custody. Did those precinct judges hand the ballots directly to you or anybody else at the Board of Elections? And she said, why no? We have kids to unload the cars. You know, Delaware County had told me the same thing, that they use Boy Scouts. Miami County blamed it on the Boy Scouts. I was getting tired of this, but my question is this. Why were kids unloading ballots for a presidential election at 12:30 in the morning on a school night during a level 10 Homeland Security alert? I don't believe her story, and here's what I think happened. This is what the precinct results and the ballots tell me. If you take a set number of ballots punched for carry, say 30 or 40, from each precinct behind closed doors, and move those ballots one precinct up the list, say from precinct 5 to precinct 4, those carry ballots will shift to Bush due to ballot rotation. Remember, the names of the candidates are not on the punch cards. In fact, there are no punches to tell the tabulator which precinct is being counted. The precinct is only printed on the back side, or it's supposed to be, but there's no punches identifying the precinct. You have to trust the Board of Elections to keep those ballots straight. And if you move those ballots one precinct up the list, you will cause collateral damage to the entire Democratic ticket because all the two-person races will flip for the races that you shift. But not everybody votes for down-ticket races, and people do split their tickets. For every 40 ballots counted for Kerry in the precincts we audited in Warren County, there were 21 votes for Connolly and 9 for Moyer. So if you move 40 ballots punch for Kerry, there's going to be a net shift of 40 Kerry votes to Bush and a net shift of 12 Connolly votes to Moyer. And lo and behold, John Kerry gets fewer votes than Ellen Connolly in so many precincts. And Warren County was the only punch card county in the state of Ohio that had both anomalies. Kerry got fewer votes than Connolly, and Bush got more votes than issue one. And if you separate out the data sets, we found in 15 audited precincts, 400 ballots that were counted in Warren County for Republican candidates for every single contested office and for gay marriage. Straight ticket, gay friendly Republicans. There would be some, but not 400. Most of these ballots were straight ticket Democratic ballots that were shifted so they'd all flip to Republican votes, and the gay marriage vote doesn't shift. When you separate out the data, In Warren County and other Connolly anomaly counties in Ohio, we found that most, 60%, sometimes two-thirds of the ballots counted for Ellen Connolly were also counted for Bush. As if most, 60%, two-thirds of Ellen Connolly's supporters, a liberal black judge from Cleveland who never set foot in southwestern Ohio, were secret admirers of George W. Bush. And we found that most, in Warren County, 51%, in other counties even more, of the ballots counted, well, punched for gay marriage were counted for Bush. And I don't know anybody who believes that if you are a supporter of gay marriage, that you are more likely to vote for Bush than for Kerry. The single biggest accomplishment that we made in any of our legal efforts was this. My initial preliminary evidence of ballot tampering in 11 counties was submitted to Federal District Court in Columbus to Judge Algernon Marbley, and we obtained from Judge Marbley an order protecting the surviving ballots from destruction. Now, as it happens, 56 out of 88 counties in Ohio did destroy at least some of their election records, especially unused ballots. And remember, J. Kenneth Blackwell told them these words: all ballots used and unused must be retained for at least 22 months. Some of these unused ballots were destroyed within 60 days. That would be before the Boxer Rebellion on the floor of the Congress, when Stephanie Tubbs Jones and Barbara Boxer challenged the election. They were already shredding evidence. That means that those blue counties, those urban counties in Ohio, cannot verify that ballots were not pre-punched in advance for third-party candidates in those heavily Democratic precincts because they haven't got the unused ballots. And those red counties with the Connolly anomalies cannot verify that fake ballots were not substituted for real ones because they cannot produce their unused ballots and they cannot account for all the ballots that were issued to them. That's why we have ballot accounting charts in all the precincts. You write down the number of ballots delivered at the start of the day, and you break them down, and the total number of voted ballots, provisional ballots, spoiled ballots where the voter asks for a second chance, and unused ballots are supposed to equal the number you started with. And if you don't save all those ballots, you cannot verify your elections. And it's not up to us to prove they're fraudulent. It's up to the boards of elections to verify the authenticity of their election results. Now, some counties destroyed the voted ballots. About 10% of them we know were destroyed, 600,000, including Montgomery County, which destroyed close to 300,000 voted ballots. This is one of those double punch counties. Our photographs of those ballots, double punched for president, are the only surviving evidence. But we think we have protected 90% of the ballots. So there's a lot of forensic evidence surviving. And I want to say one thing about the publication of my book. In the spring of 2007, I submitted letters of inquiry and the introduction to my book to 7 carefully selected publishers. After all, I am an unpublished author, an unagented author with an unsolicited manuscript. Those are 3 strikes. I've found 7 publishers that would accept these conditions, and I heard back from 3 of them 4 days later, which is a really good return. I had 3 publishers vying for the manuscript. I chose to go with Kent State University Press for a number of reasons, one of which was an email they sent me from the acquisitions editor, which I have printed on the back of my book as a blurb, as an endorsement. The research conducted, records and statistics cited, and analysis performed succeeds in telling a staggering story, one almost unbelievable, but for the documentation. Now, 4 days after the first public announcement
that this book was under contract and Kent State University Press was planning to publish it in the spring of 2008. It was in a page one banner headline in one of my hometown newspapers on October 25th of last year. 4 days later, I got an email from Kent State University Press breaking the contract. There were enough false statements in the email that I don't know the real reasons. It forced us, already traumatized and exhausted, to do all the typesetting, all the formatting, all the editing, all the graphics, and come up with $26,000 to publish this book in a hardbound cloth cover edition with stitched pages in the old-fashioned way. My research will not fall apart, and neither will the book. And it comes with a CD with 1,200 photographs of actual forensic evidence from Ohio and some of the spreadsheets as well, representing maybe 3 or 4% of our digital archives. These are arranged into folders with captions keyed to the pages in the text, and you can look at the evidence for yourselves. So the book is only available in person, or through mail order, or through PayPal, through my website, witnesstoacrime.com. And I will open the floor to questions. I think, thank you.